Okay, welcome everybody to the continuation of the NIPS competition track. The final competition, it hasn't happened yet, so thus far we've seen competitions where we're presenting the results, but we don't have all the results yet, and so because this is called the Human-Computer Question Answering Competition, we have yet to do the final stage of having a computer team face off against a human team, so that's what will be happening in just a few minutes. But before we get started with that, I wanted to explain a little bit about what we're doing and how it works. So we're going to be playing a game called Quiz Bowl. And so Quiz Bowl is a popular game in the United States and the United Kingdom, where it's called University Challenge. And what makes it different from other trivia games is that you can interrupt the question. So the question is read one word at a time, and the computer or the human needs to decide when it knows enough to answer the question. And if you buzz in and you get it right, you get points. If you get it wrong, then the question is read to the other team, and they have an opportunity to answer. So it's hard to get a sense of what's going on just from that explanation, so I'm going to do a little demo. I'm going to read a Quiz Bowl question, and hopefully you guys will shout out the answer when you know it. This man wrote ballet in which 60 white nymphs perform the rainbow dance, so named because different colored lights are focused on them. That ballet, Alethes and Iris, was never produced because the theater manager was convinced it would cause a fire. He invented the first cowcatcher and campaigned for the passage of an act against street nuisances like outdoor musicians, who he claimed wasted a quarter of his life. Did I hear an answer? Yep. Charles. All right, yeah, Charles Babbage. And so as the question goes on, you'll notice that it gets easier and easier. And so at the end, it talks about the inventor of the analytic engine and the difference engine. So computer scientists in the room should recognize that this is Charles Babbage. So these questions are constructed in such a way that they get easier as you go along. And the sooner you can buzz, the deeper your knowledge of the subject, and thus the smarter you are. And that's what we're going to try to figure out tonight, whether machines or humans can process this information better. And so, this is a longer question. The questions we'll be reading tonight are a little bit shorter. And this structure is what we'll be testing today. So, I often have to point out how this is not Jeopardy. So, in Jeopardy, you get a question in its entirety. And then the actual mechanics of the game are a little bit different. There is a countdown timer next to the board, and if you try to answer before that countdown timer has gotten zero, you can't answer the question. Because if you could interrupt the question, that would make for bad television. And so trivia aficionados believe the Quiz Bowl is a superior trivia game because it rewards people with deeper knowledge. And so I just want to talk a little bit more about why Quiz Bowl is an interesting task. So these questions are relatively long, and you have to make inferences across sentences. So, anyone know the answer to this question? Look at the end of the question where the easy part is. Magic flute, good job. This is indeed the magic flute. But let's take a look at this question in a little bit more depth. So if you look at some of the clues, so for instance, it talks about the librettist of this opera, but it doesn't mention the name of the librettist by name. So the name Emanuel Schikaneder never appears in this question. And you have to figure out who the librettist of this answer is, and you have to connect that to the character he played in the premiere. So it requires multiple hops in your knowledge base to solve this sort of clue. And you also have complicated co-reference in the lingo of natural language processing, but it's in the reverse direction from what we normally see. So you have a man, his, and then you finally get the named entity that it's referring to, in this case, Tamino. So to figure out whom they're talking about, you need to basically do co-reference backwards. And then at the very end, there's this wordplay. And so if you want to answer the magic flute, you need to solve this puzzle at the end to change an enchanted woodwind instrument into the magic flute. Okay, so this is a fun game for humans to play, but I think it's also a good game to determine how effective computers are at answering these questions and testing the depth of their knowledge. And it also tests the confidence of these algorithms, because it's making guesses after every word, and it needs to figure out when it is common enough to answer the question and to buzz in. And although you can do relatively well with simple approaches, you have to get more and more complex if you want to compete at a high level. And that's why we chose it for the competition track. It's very easy to get started. We provided a baseline system that people could improve. But it can't even get much harder than this. We're going to feed in the word as text strings, but you could ask it to do speech recognition. You could also write the questions adversarially, write the questions in such a way that they're designed to be more difficult. And so the way the system works is that you have a server that serves as a moderator for the game. A user comes in, says, "I would like to play." You have a bunch of questions. It asks to hear the first word. You get the first word. It asks for the second word since it doesn't know the answer. You get additional words, and this keeps going until the system realizes that it can answer the question, and it can answer this question with Barry Goldwater, and then get points. And the humans are going to be doing the same thing. They'll be hearing the same text, and they'll be making this decision at the same time, and we'll see whether the humans or the computers can answer the question first. Okay, so that's the system that we're going to be using for the competition. If you want to learn more, you can go to our competition webpage. You can also look at source code that solves this problem. But that's all I wanted to say about that. If you think, after seeing what happened today, that you can do better, join the mailing list on this webpage, and we'll be running another competition in 2018. So we ran a similar competition last year, and the humans beat the system. Now talking about the first phase of the competition, where the computers faced off against each other, Pedro will talk through which computer system won the competition and earned the right to face off against humans today.
All right, so competition results. So as we had 19 registered teams, 7 teams submitted full systems. Evaluation, as you might imagine, is not as simple as a Kaggle leaderboard number. You have to do something a little more sophisticated. So our two evaluations of the system were the accuracy at the time that the systems first buzzed. The reason for that is that we would like to know, as a person buzzes in, if they buzz in when they're mostly correct. But that also doesn't capture the full story, so we also played simulated games of the systems against each other, so we could see which system would win in an actual game. So, evaluated by accuracy, the winning team, Alsha, buzzed in with an 85% accuracy on the test set, and our baseline system buzzed in with 55% accuracy. So, quite a bit of an improvement from the winning team. Ace Glove and Ethereal also submitted systems who improved above the baseline, but I still think there's a lot of room for improvement as well. In the competition itself, Alsha also won in 3-0, so these simulated games were played 3 times over so that we can get a fair coverage of how the systems do against one another. In second place, Ethereal won 2 games, lost 1. Ace Love lost against the other submissions but beat the baseline, so it's nice to see that our baseline was trounced despite it being a fairly competitive baseline. So in second place, we have LUnit Ethereal, who are not here, but they submitted a white paper, which you can find on the conference proceedings. Their model was using an RNN with attention plus the Elasticsearch reference system. And rather than me trying to approximate an explanation, we have the author here to talk about how the system works. So please welcome Akio Yamada.
Okay, hi, I'm Akio Yamada with Studio Sync. So I will briefly present our quizable question answering system, which won this competition. So first, let me start with introducing ourselves briefly. We are a Tokyo-based tech startup focusing on natural language processing and deep learning. We are mainly working on question answering and entity-based semantics and won several recent competitions, including this competition. And here's the summary of this task. Given question sentences, the task is to predict the answer that is described by the sentences. One uniqueness of this task is that the question is given one word at a time, so and the system can output an answer at any time. And answer must be an FTPD entity. Okay, and this is the overview of our approach. We use two neural network models and conventional information retrieval models to address this task. We combine these models using supervised pointwise learning to rank model to that assign the relevant score to each answer. And the system simply outputs an answer if the relevant score of a top answer exceeds a threshold. Okay. So I will describe each component in the system. So the first neural network model is neural quizzable solver. This model solves a task as a text classification problem over possible answers with words and entities in a question as input. The uniqueness here is that we use entities in addition to words to capture unambiguous and salient semantic signals. And entities are automatically detected using a dictionary built from Wikipedia. Then words, entities, and answers are mapped into continuous vectors and initialized using entity vector, which is also our embedding model of words and entities proposed last year. And the representation of the question is computed simply based on the average of the word vectors and entity vectors, and the probability of each answer being correct is computed based on the dot product between the representation of the question and the answer vector. Okay. So the second neural network model is neural entity type predictor. This model aims to predict the entity types of the answer, such as person and author, given a sequence of words in a question. We also address this task as a multi-class text classification problem over entity types using convolutional neural networks. We use figure entity types to automatically assign entity types to each answer and use them as a target labels. These neural network models are trained using our large QA dataset. Because in this competition, a question is given one word at a time, it is important for our system to perform accurately for incomplete questions. So in order to achieve this, we simply truncate a question at a random position during the training. And we use stochastic gradient descent on GPU to train the neural network model. And in order to further enhance the performance, we use conventional information retrieval models. In particular, we compute multiple relevant scores using words in a question as a query. We use Wikipedia text and question in our dataset as a target document. And regarding the scoring methods, we adopt BM25 and the number of common words between a question and document. And finally, the learning to rank model assigns a relevant score to each answer. We use the state-of-the-art gradient boosted regression trees as an algorithm, and the outputs of the neural network models and IR information retrieval models as features. And the system outputs an answer if the relevant score of a top answer exceeds 0.5, which is configured manually. Also, in order to maintain accuracy for incomplete questions, we generate questions truncated at another position during the training. Okay, thank you very much.